Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Fiona Hislop on Clyde and Hebrides Ferries, Provision, Service and Harbours Update. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions on the issues following her statement. Therefore, there should be no interruptions or interventions. And I call on Fiona Hislop, Cabinet Secretary, around 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, thank you for the opportunity to make this statement. Unfortunately, the pre-election period restrictions for the UK government election meant this was the earliest opportunity for me to address the Chamber on these important issues, and there have been significant developments over the summer period. This update covers a wide range of issues relating to the support and provision of ferry services across the Clyde and Hebrides ferry network. I want to thank the crews, port staff and wider teams at CalMac and indeed Northlink for their work in providing ferry services across the busy summer period. This required dedication and flexibility to deliver services to communities served by our lifeline networks. This was not without its challenges on the Clyde and Hebrides ferry network, with two extended periods with key vessels out of service on the Cymru and Arran service. I want to further extend my thanks to the communities on those islands for their patience, understanding and flexibility throughout the period of disruption. I can advise that the MV Caledonian Isles serving Arran is expected to return this month, providing significant additional capacity in terms of passenger and car carryings. This releases the MV Alfred to provide resilience and overhaul cover. We've extended her charter until at least February next year, when new tonnage should be delivered. We are also expecting an update on the repairs to the MV Isle of Arran from CalMac later today. I was also pleased to see the MV Lough Shearer serving Cymru return to service at the start of August following repairs to her damaged ramp. The Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee received updates on the delivery schedule on the MV Glen Sannox on the 2nd of August and the MV Isle of Islay on the 8th of August. On the Glen Sannox, whilst it's regrettable that there has been further delay to the delivery of the vessel, I am pleased to confirm that the arrangements to ensure a smooth handover and entry into service are well underway. Reports from the sea trials and work to date have indicated that the vessel is performing well. We look forward to her entering service and serving the Arran community. Discussions are already underway with communities around the timetables when she initially enters service from Troon. The update on the Isle of Islay highlighted the impact of global supply chain issues, with the vessel now anticipated to be delivered towards the end of this year and enter service early in 2025. Although disappointing, there are issues beyond our control and are impacting on the wider shipping industry. CMAL indicate that the build quality is very high, and their team, along with the CalMac staff on site, are working with the shipyard to ensure a smooth handover of the vessel. We announced the launch of the procurement process for the 7 fully electric small vessels. This will enable older vessels to be replaced and cascade of some vessels to improve resilience and capacity on other routes. The initial phase of the procurement concludes in early October, and shortlisted shipyards will submit bids towards the end of the year. Work is also underway around port improvements and the power upgrades to support these vessels when they come into service from 2027. It is equally important, Presiding Officer, to ensure that our port and harbour network is fit for purpose while providing a high standard of passenger experience. Work to allow the new Islay-class vessels to berth at Kennacraig and Port Askey are now substantially complete. The Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity recently visited these works en route to engagements on Islay. Work at Colonsay should finish in the autumn. Work on the Little Minch ports is now substantially complete. Lochmaddy and Tarbert are finished, and work is well underway on the terminal building at Uig. This major programme of works has delivered a combination of replacing life-expired infrastructure and increasing flexibility and resilience by allowing a larger range of major vessels to use these ports. This represents investment of over £100 million supported by the Scottish Government. Work to develop the final design and business case for Port Ellen is also underway. The preferred option being developed should tackle existing restrictions, with the marshalling at the port can be addressed and allowing full benefit of the 40% uplift in capacity of the new vessels, but also represents an opportunity to incorporate drop trailer facilities for freight. On Adrosson, I understand that all outstanding elements are being completed and that I will receive the new business plan shortly. This includes considerations of the funding requirements and recurring lease costs, including progressing the legal respective agreements to protect the interests of government in terms of cost and ensuring a robust and resilient port can be maintained well into the future. Once I have had an opportunity to consider the new business plan, I will undertake to communicate the next steps directly with interested members and wider task force, which would be reconvened as soon as possible. I can assure the Chamber that this remains a key priority for ministers. On the CHIFS contract, as I confirmed in May, whilst good progress is being made in relation to the direct award of the next CHIFS contract, it was necessary to extend the current contract by a period of up to 12 months. We have now published the public consultation response report on the CHIFS 3 contract, building on the earlier work by Angus Campbell. Transport Scotland officials visited 11 islands and held 22 public events, in addition to focused discussion with key ferry stakeholders. The formal consultation saw 434 responses received, and I want to thank those who contributed and also the groups and organisations across islands who helped set out the engagement and help officials reach communities. I assure those who contributed that these responses will help inform and shape the next CHIFS contract in a way that focuses on community needs and putting the customer's voice and experience at the heart of decision making. On the direct award due diligence work, this continues at pace with a submission to the Competition and Markets Authority due imminently as the next key milestone in taking us to the go-no-go decision on direct award early next year. I will further update the Parliament on progress at that appropriate time. I said that there would need to be improvement and change, and one of the key mechanisms that will help drive that change is the CalMAC Enhancement and Change Plan, which was published in July. This reflects feedback from communities around how they can help better influence service delivery. A key element of the plan is to enhance the number of local area managers across the network to enable decisions on services to be driven by the often distinct circumstances around different routes. There will now be 6 regions rather than 3, covering Clyde, Islay, Arran, Argyll Islands and Hebrides North and Hebrides South. This will enable greater engagement with customers and business users. These core roles should be empowered to influence decisions that impact their communities. Transport Scotland officials have also been engaging with the Ferry Community Board, along with CalMAC, to design and define the key performance indicators that will be used to monitor the success of service delivery, with the lived experience of users at the heart of these. I expect to see these new measures and elements of the Enhancement and Change Plan brought in and refined across the extension period. I've also outlined that we will have the requirement for a ferry community board set out as part of the new CHIFS contract. Workshops have been held with the board to help consider how its role can be further defined and strengthened to help it drive forward improvements in services and to further consider strategic issues across the CalMAC network. I thank the board members for their dedicated work on supporting the development of key issues to date. I am also aware that there have been calls for greater island representation on the boards of ferry bodies. I agree, and this is also my aim. I am pleased that both CalMAC and CMAL now have islanders on their board and are working hard to make sure island residents have opportunities to be involved. I will continue to stress to both bodies the necessity of ensuring the communities they serve are represented at the highest levels of the organisation. On the Islands Connectivity Plan, we have now published today the consultation report on the Islands Connectivity Plan, following a similarly expansive engagement with communities across both the CHIFS and NIFS networks, who engaged on this important work that will help form policy for ferries and the investment in ports and vessels into the future. We're considering the feedback received and will look to make any changes to the two documents before formal publication as soon as possible. Presiding Officer, our focus on these issues demonstrates this Government's commitment to ferry services that are fit for the future. As well as ongoing and planned investments, we have in recent years been able to freeze fares or minimise increases. However, it would be remiss of me not to highlight the stark financial backdrop against which these plans I have outlined are set. We will continue to take forward our ambitious programme, but difficult decisions will be needed around all aspects of ferry services as these business cases come to fruition. Thank you for the opportunity to update Parliament on these important matters. I know they've been extensive and varied, but a lot has happened over recent months. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I'd invite members wishing to ask a question who haven't already done so to press the request to speak buttons. And I call first Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much indeed. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of the statement? I've got to say, Presiding Officer, I was full of excitement and expectation. But once again, the Cabinet Secretary has dashed my hopes that we would get some good news. We warned there could be a summer of ferries chaos, and there has been a summer of ferries chaos. Not a day goes by when we don't hear about more delays, cancellations and repairs. Islanders are long past being at their wits' end. There's little in this statement that we didn't know already, but the Cabinet Secretary managed to save the worst till last. In a doom-laden ending that would give Keir Starmer a run for his money. She warns of difficult decisions as business cases come to fruition. Now, she mentions Ardrossan, so is one of these difficult decisions about Ardrossan? Is the work on that port likely to be put on hold? And if not, when are we likely to see any progress? And finally, will she agree to a full debate on ferries in government time so that we can properly address all the issues?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I understand there have been disruption on certain services, but I would reiterate that the vast majority of ferry services have been completed, and it is a disservice to the staff of CalMac to say otherwise. I know there have been particular problems. I've addressed them firsthand in relation to the Isle of Cymru and Isle of Arran, and I've given updates on that. We know that there can be technical problems. We also know that there can also be weather issues in terms of berthing. So these things happen, but I think it is wrong to say that it has been the situation as relayed by Graeme Simpson. And I would also remind him that it's not me or Keir Starmer that talked about or introduced the 9% capital cuts that are facing the Scottish Government's budget. That actually was the Conservative Party. I would like to see a change in the fiscal regime that would actually replace that capital reduction, but I'm afraid that's where it came from. Now, I'm not just saying in my own budget, but in others, there will be challenges. Having said that, can I just reiterate, I actually, in my statement, talked about, and I think it is good news, he was obviously the member that doesn't have an interest in ports and harbours on the basis that I've just announced that we've invested £100 million successfully in that work. And I also talked about the announcement of £175 million of the procurement of the small vessels replacement. That also is very welcome. And on Ardrossan, I also gave the welcome news that I'm expecting the new business plan anytime now, and I will convene the task force, who quite rightly are in the position, they've already been involved as individual stakeholders, to take forward that piece of work. So I know Graeme Simpson is all doom and gloom, but even he should see there were elements, I think, of success and progress and commitment in the statement I've just been given.
Thank you. As with the previous statement, there's a lot of interest in asking questions. This will require responses to be a little bit briefer, but also those who've asked a question to then stop talking while the answers are being given. Alec Rowley.
Presiding Officer, I note the Cabinet Secretary's remarks at the end of her statement that it would be remiss of her not to highlight the stark financial backdrop against which these plans are set, and that difficult decisions will be needed around all aspects of ferry services. Is this just not a get-out clause for everything that comes before? It would be remiss of me not to remind the Cabinet Secretary of the Government's monumental overspend and failure in procuring Saxon and Rosa. Why should the passengers and staff across the public ferry network be made to pay for the financial incompetence of the Scottish Government? I also note the comments regarding the direct award of the CHFS contract. It was my understanding that this decision would be announced this summer, so can the Cabinet Secretary explain what has caused the major delay in announcing the Scottish Government's approach, leading to yet more uncertainty for staff for islanders on vital ferry services?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the first point I would reflect that there is a situation that we have known about, that there is a capital pressures facing the Scottish Government, and that is that's just a reality, and I think it would be wrong not to address that. But I do think in terms of how we take things forward, it actually re-emphasises the point for value for money to be demonstrated, and that's the work particularly on the Drossen business case that I've been very keen to see progressed. On his point about the direct award on shifts, can I gently remind the member that I did give indication to Parliament quite clearly and openly and transparently that we would be extending the current shifts to award for up to another year. I hope it doesn't take that long, but we would need to do that because there are elements of what we were doing, particularly going to the CMA, also as I mentioned in my remarks about the Harbours Agreement. So that was known publicly even before recess. So the issue now is making sure that we get everything in order so that we can, as my preference, I think it's his as well, move to the direct award decision. So the CHIFS 2 extension was announced prior to recess, and what I'm saying is on the CHIFS 3 that I'm hoping that we'll be getting to the position that we can move to the progress of the go-ahead with that to give everybody the certainty, not least the staff, that they need. But I would gently remind the member that I did set that out before recess.
I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Welcome confirmation that the MV Caledonian Isles will soon return to service. My island constituents will benefit from the much-needed additional capacity and resilience, given that their Drossen to Broderick service has again been disrupted for the fifth day in a row. Meanwhile, redevelopment of a Drossen harbour drags on and on without a decision. Today, the Cabinet Secretary said it's a key priority and the Government is committed to retaining a Drossen as a mainland port for Arran. It did so in 2017. 7 years later, not a single shovel has hit the ground, and I appreciate that business plan is on its way, but when will all this seemingly endless uncertainty finally be lifted and a decision to proceed taken?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I share the members' frustrations and that of the communities of Arran and Drossen. A decision can only be undertaken when the vital business casework is completed. As stated, the work continues. Significant changes to the estimated project costs, outstanding legal and lease matters have been the issues that have been addressed more recently, and that obviously in turn will impact on the partners, not saying the government's, the partners' financial packages, and we've got to give them time to make sure that they have developed them. What I am saying is that I expect that business plan to be presented to me very shortly, and obviously at that point we can ensure, and that's why all the work is going in to demonstrate the business case, both in the social, the economic, but also the value for money perspective. That work is completing. I expect to see the new business plan soon, and I will, as I said, convene the task force as soon as possible after that so we can move forward.
Jamie Green to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before recess, my questions about the delivery of the Glen Sannox were met with nothing less than evasion. Hours after recess started, bad news was snuck out to the media. I have to say the disruption to the Isle of Arran this summer has been endless, and it's very costly to island businesses. The main Arran ferry has been out of action for most of this year. The temporary replacement vessel has been out of action now for 5 days, as others have mentioned. And the new Arran ferry, we still have yet no delivery date in today's statement. What faith can islanders have that this coming winter will be any better than the disastrous summer that they've already had?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the delivery date for Glen Sannox was communicated as appropriate to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, and indeed the date was set out as the 30th September during that communication to the committee over the summer. So therefore, what I was talking about is the delivery of that and the plans for the delivery, and that's why the sea trials that are ongoing are very important, and it's very pleasing to hear that they are going well. In terms of the issues that have faced the Caledonian Isles, that is obviously frustrating. I do know that obviously in terms of there are other ways and other means by which people can provide access in terms of the MV Alfred and also the other route. Obviously, latterly, the Isle of Arran problems have caused issues. These are technical issues. I think people want to make sure their vessels are safe, and therefore it's appropriate if there are technical problems, they are addressed. I can tell you that it's expected to have communication at 8 o'clock this evening, I understand, about potential for tomorrow's sailings from the Isle of Arran. I know that's not satisfactory for those that have been disrupted over the last week, but I can relay the most recent information that I've been given.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Ensuring that the Glen Sannox and the Glen Rosa is clearly the immediate priority, but it's also vital that Ferguson's is supported fully to bid for future work. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what support it's providing, not just for the funding, but also to help get the current ferries delivered and also to set the yard up for future success?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I'm not providing funding for the Ferguson's yard. That is the responsibility of the Deputy First Minister, and the Deputy First Minister has set out the provision of £14 million to ensure that the yard can become as competitive and productive as possible to win future bids, which is what we want it to see. I understand also that Ferguson's have indicated that they will want to bid for the SVRP Phase 1 vessels, and that is the procurement of that is the responsibility of myself, and information about that was also set out over the summer.
Rhoda Grant to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The statement doesn't mention freight capacity at all. The building of the Western Isles interconnector will require almost all the current capacity for freight on the Loch Seaforth, while the building of new distilleries and islet will increase freight traffic there. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how she intends to increase freight capacity and whether ferries due to be replaced will be kept in the fleet to provide that additional capacity where and when required into the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, actually, I did refer to freight, particularly in reference to Port Ellen. She'll know that Port Ellen and Isla is one of the key ports that are used by and would want to be used by the whisky industry going forward. And I specifically talked about drop load freight capacity being considered as part of the plans for Port Ellen. So it's incorrect to say that I didn't mention freight. And of course, the new capacity that will be available for increased HGVs on both the Glen Sannox, but also on the Isla. I think it's 55% on the Isla class in terms of the services to Isla will help support them. I think she raises a very good and important point in relation to the Western Isles in relation to renewable energy companies and Transport Scotland. And my officials took part in a meeting with the wider economic interests in the Council and others in terms of the economic development and the requirement for freight there. You will recall, and you'll be perfectly, so the minister, the member will be perfectly aware that CalMac is heavily subsidised by the Scottish Government. We obviously have a number of private energy companies who will be making significant profits from renewable energy. I think collectively together we can work together to identify how we can maximise the use of everybody's resources to increase freight capacity, but I do think she's raising a serious point, and I can reassure I'm taking that forward as one of the areas that I think I need to work with my colleagues both in energy and the economy on to make sure that we have plans for the future that will meet that future capacity needs of the renewable energy interest.
Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for providing today's statement. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to ensure that the Scottish Government continue to reiterate to Caledonia McBrayne that it is crucial for island communities to feel that they are both kept up to date with and involved in relevant discussions regarding the lifeline services which the islands rely on?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do, and I stress the importance of establishing the Ferry Community Board as part of the CHIFS 3 contract and indeed their role in identifying the KPIs of that contract. In addition, in terms of the enhancement and change plan that was announced by CalMac, I did say that it is not business as usual. There has to be change. Having six regions with six area managers would enable, I think, a more responsive and ability to respond to needs and services, but also importantly communication, because in my discussion with islanders, communications of what can be recognised as genuinely needed changes in service is also an important aspect of what that improvement can look like.
Ariane Burgess to be followed by Bob Doris.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for her statement. It's good to hear progress being made across the CalMac network. As a Highlands and Islands MSP, I know that the performance and future of our ferries and the ports are a source of deep concern and frustration. Beyond the unavoidable tidal and weather-related issues, 10 ferry routes in my region are today on restricted timetables or cancelled altogether. While I welcome the proposals for 6 local area manager posts in the CalMAC Enhancement and Change Plan, and news that there are some local people already in place, can the Minister outline what has been put in place to ensure that island communities will always be embedded in the decision-making of their ferry services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there will be different routes for that. I think the issue in terms of the KPIs will embed islanders' lived experience in relation to satisfaction within that. The whole point of having a direct award is that the delivery by CalMAC will be focused on delivering public service rather than working simply to deliver a pre-existing contract and working to contract. I also think in terms of, as I've mentioned before, the critical role of the Ferry Community Board. And I also think in terms of the representation of islanders, not as necessarily as representing any particular island, but to bring an islander perspective to that wider governance will be a requirement in relation to boards of both CalMAC and CMAL.
Bob Doris to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Cabinet Secretary, clearly there's a lot of detail in your statement, and there's also clearly a pipeline of new vessels which are going to be added to the network in the near future. Does the Scottish Government have any figures regarding the net benefit of all these new vessels in terms of increased capacity on vessels and also, just as important, island communities, the network resilience?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, clearly, in terms of the capacity issues I've referenced already, I think, in answer to another member, for the Isla routes, the two new vessels, MV Isle of Isla and MV Lochendale, will have increased capacity. They'll have 14 HGVs, each have also for deck capacity for 100 passengers. Overall, the vessels have space for 20 HGVs if you combine them, and compared to the maximum of 18 HGVs on existing vessels, that does equate to 55% more deck space for HGVs. That also will apply to the sister vessels, which will obviously have a similar capacity configuration. On the small vessel replacement programme, phase one, you will see the increase in capacity there equate to a 40% increase. But of course, another aspect will be in relation to reliability and resilience with new vessels coming into the fleet, and the reliable and resilient ferry services will automatically, obviously, increase available capacity on some key routes.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Jamie Halker-Johnston.
There is little that generates more public anger than the scandal of the ferries, and we've had yet more of that again today. Broken aging ferries again, delayed new ferries again, and stranded islanders again. And the Cabinet Secretary has been particularly evasive today. She's been asked a number of times about what she's referring to when she's saying that cuts are coming because of the financial position. I think she's got a duty to spell out to the Chamber today exactly what she means.
Cabinet Secretary.
So going forward, we have to ensure that the public purse can deliver on key public services. This government is focused on delivering on 4 key missions. Improving public services is one of them. As part of the transport aspect of public services, ferries are clearly one of those. But it would be wrong for me to identify that having frozen fares in the past, having minimised increases in costs in other areas, in terms of looking at all the future developments, both of ports and harbours and a number of areas, it means that we have to drive down and be harder and smarter at making sure the business cases that are presented to us for delivery get value for money, because we're doing this in a context of years of austerity. And as Shona Robertson quite rightly pointed out, it was actually the Liberal Democrats, as part of the Conservative Liberal Democrat government, that heralded the start of austerity in this country.
Jamie Halker-Johnston to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Oh, thank you very much. The MV Alfred was first chartered in April 2023 for an initial period of 9 months at a cost of £9 million, or £1 million per month. There have now been 2 further extensions, with the latest extension scheduled to end in March 2025. That will mean the MV Alfred will have been chartered for just short of 24 months. So can the Cabinet Secretary advise me of the total cost of that charter to the taxpayer? And if she doesn't have that figure to hand, can Fiona Hislop at least confirm whether or not the total cost of this nearly two-year charter is more or less than the reported £14.5 million cost to Pentland Ferries to buy the vessel outright in the first place?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I expect that it would. I think it's right that I, as the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, and indeed my predecessors, ensured that there was cover and resilience for our island's communities on the CHIFS network. I don't think the member is suggesting we shouldn't have done that. In terms of purchasing, we have continually looked at purchasing of vessels in order to help resilience, actually not least for freight, and as he knows very well, for freight for the NIFS network in particular. So is it satisfactory? No, it's not. As the Minister is representing the customer base, for receipt of the incoming ferries. Of course, I am as frustrated as others are, and also in relation to that increased cost in terms of providing that additional cover. That is frustrating, but obviously in terms of purchase, there has to be a willing seller to be able to purchase from, and at a satisfactory price. I'm not referring necessarily to the MV Alfred, but all the other vessels that we're looking at. But there are particular needs that we have, and obviously in terms of the Arran route in particular, it has proved very important and helpful in providing that cover. But I do look forward to those six new vessels by 2026 and the seven new small vessels replacements that I announced in the summer are being procured, actually starting to provide that absolutely necessary resilience in the Scottish fleet.
And Emma Roddick.
Officer, I've received a lot of communication over the summer from islanders who haven't been able to make ferry journeys that were necessary. I wonder, has the Scottish Government given any thought to making contractual provision for a SAMHSA-style ticketing system whereby separate allocations are maintained to ensure that islanders are given an equitable level of priority on sailings in the next CHIFS contract?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the CHIFS 2 contract included a commitment for a smart ticketing platform, but in particularly in relation to the issue of islanders and places for islanders on routes. The member may not be aware, but we're already piloting that on the current deck space reservation pilot for Mull, Col and Tyree. And in CalMAC's Enhancement and Change Plan, published in July, if this pilot has delivered the intended benefit, the intention there, as announced, is to engage with communities to have a rollout of that to in order islanders to have reserved places. And we know that's essential for short notice and particular pressurised immediate sailings that islanders have to have. So I can reassure the member that not only are we thinking about it, we're piloting it already, and there's a commitment to roll it out should that prove successful.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement on Clyde and Hebrides ferries. We move on to the next item of business. I'll allow a moment for front benches to organise themselves.